governor of New York has said that Sandy is more devastating than Katrina. And to back up that claim, New Jersey and New York are requesting from the federal government $71 billion, that's B for billion dollars, to clean up and to restore some infrastructure after the devastation of Superstorm Sandy.
Well, the cleanup and the recovery from the hurricane will take years. New York's governor says the damage from Sandy was in some ways, as Pat was saying, worse than Katrina. Charlene Israel has that story.
Sandy destroyed more than 300,000 houses in New York alone, with widespread damage across the state. Governor Andrew Cuomo met with local and state officials to review damage assessments and discuss the cost to repair the damage to housing, parks, and infrastructure.
When you look at the breakdown in terms of numbers, our recovery cost is about $32 billion. Originally, we had estimated it to be about 30, so it's right about where we thought it would be.
Cuomo says considering the state's population and amount of homes and businesses affected, the storm caused more havoc than Hurricane Katrina.
When you look at the damage done, the economic damage, the housing damage, the damage to commercial properties, because of the density of New York, the number of people affected, the number of properties affected, was much larger in Hurricane Sandy than in Hurricane Katrina. And that puts this entire conversation, I believe, in focus.
New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg plans to travel to Washington to make the city's case with congressional leaders.
There are some roughly 6,000 privately owned, multiple unit residential buildings in the area hit hardest by Hurricane Sandy in Queens, on Staten Island, and in South Brooklyn.
In neighboring New Jersey, the storm caused massive damage to the transit system and coastline.
Tourism is a $38 billion industry for this state. That is the economic engine of this area. The two key things would be getting our residents back into their homes and get our tourism industry rebuilt.
Residents in the state need lots of help.
95% of what I own is devastated.
And they're not sure how long it will take for them to recover from Sandy.
I don't know if I ever will. Like, you know, I'm probably going to take a $200,000 hit, and at 65, that's quite a chunk of your savings.
Meanwhile, nearly a month after Sandy, CBN's Operation Blessing is still on the scene in both New York and New Jersey. Volunteers have been cleaning homes and distributing food to victims. The day before Thanksgiving, volunteers served Thanksgiving dinners to those affected by the storm. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Well, Thanksgiving dinner at Breezy Point was a big deal, and lots of people showed up. I mean, there was about 2,500 or so.
You know, when there's that kind of devastation, it's very hard to reach out in any way people really feel is easing their pain.
Well, you help them rebuild their houses, which is what we're doing, and Operation Blessing has gotten a tremendous thing. Well, Bill Holran is head of Operation Blessing. He's going to be here to tell us about what that organization is doing. You know, a lot of these charities come in, take pictures, and then leave. We don't do it. We don't do it. We stay there. We stay and help. And we're probably the longest survivor in New Orleans to help those devastated areas. And we'll be helping the people in Queens and Staten Island and out in Long Island long after some of the other charities have pulled up stakes and left. So we're very pleased. By the way, as a treat, in answer to the demand of his fans, we have the Super Dog Blue. There is Blue having a little snack in the green room. Isn't he a magnificent creature?
He is magnificent. Look at him with this CBN
badge. He's such a sweet dog.
He's
and everybody loves him. They wanted to say, what is happening to Blue? Well, Blue is the mascot of Operation Blessing, and isn't he sweet? All right. But first, did you ever watch Two and a Half Men?
No, I did not.
You never watched it?
Never watched
it. In all
it.
Your life, you never watched it? It's one of the most popular shows on the air. But it is just loaded with sexual innuendo, and I mean, every show, I mean, it's just loaded with it. And so the child star, the half man, who was a little boy, he's now, you know, in college, I guess, or post-college, he's spoken out against his own TV show. And Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom.
Pat, that's right. The teenage actor in the CBS comedy Two and a Half Men is telling people to stop watching the program because it's, quote, filth. Two and a Half Men, as Pat mentioned, is known for its raunchy humor and sexually explicit dialogue. 19-year-old Angus T. Jones has played the character Jake since he was 10. Now he says he wants out. Jones attended a Christian school when he was younger, but he said his faith has been non-existent. He's had a spiritual awakening, though, and says he wants to leave the show, but can't. Instead, he's encouraging viewers to simply tune out.
Please stop watching Two and a Half Men. I'm on Two and a Half Men. I don't want to be on it. Please stop watching it. Please stop filling your head with filth.
You cannot be a true God-fearing person and be on a television show like that. I know I can't. I'm not okay with what I'm learning, what the Bible says, and being on that television show.
Forerunner Christian Church in California posted that video, and Jones attends a Seventh-day Adventist church, Pat, in California.
It's amazing. They bounced Charlie Sheen, who was the lead actor of the thing, because of his drunken tirades. And so here you've got two of them, and Sheen has been replaced by another actor who gets $1 million per episode.
Wow. I guess it's because of contractual commitments that he can't walk from that.
Well, I mean, they're going to, you know, tear their hair out. You know, a few episodes back, they had him hooked up with some stripper type, and so his character was having an affair. So I guess he doesn't think that's too cool, but it's a very popular show. I mean, CBS has got that, and then the Big Bang Theory, which is more it's more cerebral.
Okay,
have you seen?
No.
No, that's not. I mean, it's about science. These people are all a bunch of nerds, it's really very funny. But that's the number one comedy on CBS. So Two and a Half Men has been a real. But imagine paying the lead actor that they recruited to take Charlie Sheen's place $1 million per episode. Well, there's a region in Spain that's known as Catalonia. You probably haven't heard much about it, but Catalonia has as many people as Belgium, and it has as many as Portugal, excuse me. It's a very prosperous region, and Lee has more about what's going on in Catalonia.
Yeah, voters in that region of Spain, Catalonia, Pat, delivered a mixed message on the issue of secession this weekend. A majority supported political parties who favor pulling out of Spain, but they did not make any clear decision on who should lead the secession movement. The regional president who called for the vote ended up losing seats in parliament. So at this point, it's unclear if Catalonia will hold a referendum on secession, but some analysts believe the chances that it will are getting better. The road to an agreement on the so-called fiscal cliff in Washington may be blocked by an unexpected issue, a change in the Senate rule on filibusters. Majority Leader Harry Reid and Republican Minority Leader Mitch McConnell are at odds over that issue. Filibusters allow an individual senator to block a bill or a nomination by simply talking about it endlessly until 60 senators vote to stop it. Reid says he just wants to make a small change to the rule so the Senate can operate more efficiently. But Senator McConnell says Reid is trying to give more power to the Democratic majority. And he says if they cannot agree on the filibuster rule, Pat, it will hurt their ability to work together on the fiscal cliff issue.
You know, Lee, some years ago, the Democrats were in the minority. The Republicans had a majority. And they used that threat of filibuster to block countless nominations for circuit court judges. Some of these fine judges were coming up, and the senator from New York particularly led the charge. And it got to be, you had to have a 60-vote majority, which is what you need to invoke what they call cloture to shut off debate. But it used to be that Jimmy Stewart, you remember, when Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, he was on the floor till his voice gave out. That's the way the filibusters used to be. They had to keep the floor, and if they left the floor, they lost the privilege of talking. Now they just say, I'm going to filibuster, and that's all it took. They just announced their intention, and the Senate says, okay, well, we won't take that measure up. But it does allow a dictatorship of a minority. But it's interesting that having used that tactic so skillfully, the Democrats are now going to impose what was called the nuclear option. And everybody was horrified that the rules of the Senate were going to be changed by the oppressive Republican majority. Now the oppressive Democrat majority says we're going to use the nuclear option, and Senator Reid is laughing quietly behind the scenes. Lee.
The Supreme Court is reviving Liberty University's lawsuit against President Obama's health care plan. The high court is ordering a federal appeals court to rule on the case it previously declined to hear. Liberty had argued requirements like the birth control mandate violate its religious freedom. The Supreme Court dismissed Liberty's suit, however, when it ruled the law constitutional earlier this year, but the college petitioned the court to reopen the case against the contraception mandate. Several other religious organizations have filed similar challenges. Well, believe it or not, the American Academy of Pediatrics says doctors should prescribe emergency contraceptives for teens, even before they're sexually active. The group released a new position paper saying drugs like Plan B should be made available to girls under the age of 17. It says it could reduce the number of teen pregnancies and even open the door to talking with them about abstinence. The paper said many pediatricians do not prescribe emergency contraceptives ahead of time, possibly because they do not want teens to become sexually active. Drugs like Plan B can prevent a pregnancy even after unprotected sex, but pro-life advocates say that it can actually cause an abortion. Pro-life activists who protest at abortion clinics may think they're simply exercising their freedom of speech, but a growing number have become the target of federal lawsuits. Paul Strand explains.
For decades, pro-life protesters have lined up outside abortion clinics, trying to convince women to save the lives of their unborn children.
You do not have to patronize a child-killing institution.
Various laws put restrictions on these protests. A major one is FACE, or the Freedom of Access to Clinic Entrances Act. Convicted protesters can face thousands in fines as well as jail time. Just the legal costs can go over $100,000. The feds have steadily stepped up the number of FACE cases these last few years. Some consider this a blatant case of federal overreach.
It's just a source of mischief by the federal government.
Lawyer Rebecca Messall represents one of the Fed targets, this couple, Ken and Joe Scott. They are longtime protesters outside Planned Parenthood in Denver, the nation's second largest abortion clinic.
In the old days of our country, they would throw Baptist preachers into jail for evangelizing out in the public. And here it seems like a regression by this administration to do the same thing. People out on the public sidewalk preaching the Word of God, preaching the Bible, preaching repentance, and they're being punished for it.
At taxpayer expense, the Justice Department put five federal prosecutors on the Scott case. Joe Scott settled last year, but it wasn't that easy for Ken, who faced 10 charges of obstructing the entrance to the clinic's parking lot.
They could have asked for $10,000 for each incident, and they alleged 10 incidents over 2 years.
Ken Scott says this can be intimidating.
And they're going to sue you and take your income away from you or your possessions. A lot of people are frightened of that.
Joe Scott points to the political power of Planned Parenthood's leader, Cecile Richards.
They're trying to shut down free speech at abortion clinics, but then Cecile Richards is one of the most frequent visitors to the White House, so you know she's having an impact.
But the Scotts vow to go on.
There are babies dying right here in this Planned Parenthood. They kill 25 to 35 a day, 5 days a week here.
Jesus said, because they hate me, they're going to hate you. And it's just part of the job description. I don't feel like a victim. I belong to Jesus.
The thing is, lately, the government is having a tough time winning these cases.
The Justice Department brought 10 claims against Ken Scott, and the judge in the case said not one of the 10 had any merit.
A Florida federal judge threw out a case accusing Justice of plotting with the abortion clinic targeted by the protester. He wrote, "The court can only wonder whether this action was the product of a concerted effort between the government and PWC, the Presidential Women's Center, which began well before the date of the incident at issue." Justice dropped the case and paid the protester $120,000 in damages. As for the charge of collusion, Messall believes it's a widespread problem in these cases.
What we learned later on was that there was a pre-commitment by the Justice Department in Washington in the Civil Rights Division to bring these cases even before they knew of the cases.
And although the government isn't winning in court, FACE Act remains on the books.
it's dangerous in so many ways. And it's been used here and across the country to try and intimidate and punish people for exercising their First Amendment rights.
Paul Strand, CBN News, Denver.
And Pat, these folks who are exercising their First Amendment rights must be having an impact, or the federal government and Planned Parenthood wouldn't be all up in arms about it.
We have a what's been called the abortion distortion. We have a society of death, and those on the left claim to be liberals, but they want death. They want to kill off old people or facilitate the euthanasia of old people. They want to do away with unborn children. They seem to, and they get passionate about the whole thing. I mean, they're wild. I mean, literally wild in demonstrations when they go out against the pro-life advocates. And all these pro-lifers are just basically saying is to the expectant mothers, would you please think a little bit about what you're doing within you as a human being, and perhaps you don't want to terminate its life. That's that's what they're doing. Perhaps there are other ways of doing it. I think there are other ways. I think one of the things that we could do is defund Planned Parenthood, keep it from getting money from the federal government. It's a huge amount of money. And, you know, interestingly enough, in those budget negotiations a year or so ago, the president would have been willing to shut the government down in order to preserve federal funding for Planned Parenthood. Well, there's a case right now in California and another one in Texas that's going to deal a body blow to Planned Parenthood. Why? Because they have been triple billing the federal government for the so-called procedures they do, and it is a scandal of major proportions, and this is a civil lawsuit. But if you want to hurt somebody, I think a better way of doing it than going out with placards and ladders outside of their building is to cut the source of their funds.
We talk about biting the hand that feeds you. I mean, as far as the California situation is concerned.
Well, they just lie. They're not biting. They're getting a double helping and a triple helping. And the American Center for Law and Justice has an active lawsuit now in California, and it's survived a challenge or so. Interestingly enough, the Ninth Circuit was on the side of the ACLJ because this was clearly fraud against the government. And so that has overcome several objections, and it looks like it may be coming to trial. So that we're talking about major damage, a whole lot more than demonstrators with placards.
We'll keep you posted on what happens with that.
Ugandan lawmakers are set to vote on a new anti-homosexuality bill. The bill proposes tough jail time for consensual same-sex behavior. Amnesty International is calling on the Ugandan parliament not to pass it. It says the bill violates non-discrimination treaties, but Uganda's parliamentary speaker says she wants the legislation to pass before Christmas. Homosexuality is illegal in most African countries, and in several nations, the death penalty can be imposed. The first official sign of Christmas arrives at the steps of the U.S. Capitol in Washington. It took 3 weeks for the 65-foot Engelmann spruce to travel all the way from the White River National Forest in Colorado to the west front lawn of the Capitol building. The tree made nearly 30 stops across the country before it reached its final destination. When it's fully decorated, it will boast about 5,000 handcrafted ornaments from its native Colorado. The lighting ceremony for the Capitol Christmas tree is next Tuesday. And you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.